You want to tell people how many shots this makes in an hour?
How many shots?
This is nine shots of espresso in under an hour.
From Starbucks too. Yeah. Those are kind of bigger shots.
I'm ready. When are we gonna shoot? Strangely enough, caffeine doesn't really faze me. I don't know if it's because I grew up like on sodas and bad stuff, but like, I mean, it'll help me out. But it doesn't, you know, some people get really goosed. Mm-hmm. I don't get really goosed.
Wow, you're not a goose?
Halfway through this, my teeth are like chattering and I'm like, what's wrong? I don't understand.
Okay, so tell me your goals.
Oh, my goals are to up my game.
Yes.
Look alive. And more eye contact with this here device.
Yes.
Less eye contact with you, not because I don't care, love, and want the best for you, but because I care, love, and want the best for them, and I want to make sure I engage with them, and I'm going to glance over at you occasionally, right? Because you're like mentoring me on my...
I'm like a mentor. Yeah.
You're like a mentor.
Yeah.
More like a Mentos. Spicy and... What are Mentos?
It's minty.
Minty, yeah. Dive in deep. I want to get like, if I had laser, if we could like superimpose, I don't know what our technological abilities are, but if we could go like that, that's what I'm looking for. I want to like
laser beams.
I want a laser beam on in.
Check.
Right? Laser beams? Check. Okay, are we ready to do we need any prep time? Do you need to like, you're just like coming in cold. Do you want to come in out of the cold?
I love to be in the cold.
You love to be in the cold?
Yeah.
You like the spontaneity?
Well, we have to talk about a few things first, which I know you've got written down on your little sheet.
Right? My little sheet of the show?
Yeah.
Yeah, what do you want to chat about?
Well, I was just going to say you're leaving. I'm sure that's up there. Sean to Nola.
Of course it is. Of course it is. So let's jump into this, right? So if all goes well, I'm splitting out Monday, and I'm off to Nola for 6 weeks, and technically 6 weeks. We've got a train the trainers in Portland, Oregon. So I'll be flying out for probably what, Laura, like 7 days, something
probably,
like that.
Yeah.
So I'll probably be doing like 7 days. Britt's gonna fly down to watch my scoundrels in New Orleans. And I think she's got a little anniversary coming up too.
Yeah, it's
so it's
year.
10 year, good Lord, she's got a 10 year anniversary. What is she like 16 and she's got a 10 year anniversary. So they've been together a long time. And so they're gonna come down, it's gonna work out really nice. She's gonna watch my guys while I'm gone, and also she's actually from New Orleans or right across the water in Mandeville. So for her, it's an opportunity to come back, like work with some clients, watch my guys, which she misses, and also have some good old New Orleans fun and show her dude around. So that's really cool. And then we've got Laura leaving. When do you leave for Norway?
The 30th.
So I'm leaving, what's the date? What does that
15th?
Make me? The 15th? Yeah. So, and then like 2 weeks later, you're splitting out. And you're going back to the country
the land of
your home.
Yeah.
And your forefathers and foremothers and four grandmothers. Are you excited?
I'm very excited. Yep.
Last time you were there?
Last time I was there was before you and I started working with the good dog.
Really? Wow, the good dog has absorbed your family life.
Basically, yes.
Was it wintertime?
This is the first time that I'm going to be back since starting work.
Maddie.
With us. So that's
Was it wintertime or summertime?
Probably spring.
Probably spring? Okay, cool. Yeah. So it should be pretty nice when you're out there right now.
It's gonna be gorgeous.
Norway in the summertime. I've been there. Poof, it's so beautiful.
Well, it's not going to be the summer. It's going to be the fall. October.
I just heard that it was fall because Brittany stormed in here very, very, very irate that Starbucks had changed their menu from summer to fall. And she was like, I want a mango lemonade. And they're like, sorry, lady, we're in fall. And she's like, it's 100 degrees. So we're all battling our demons, right? So
I had
so,
a little pumpkin thing the other day, a little pumpkin in my almond latte, which is very fall.
So I'm very happy for you. I'm excited you get to go see your four fathers.
Yes.
And you're going to do any adventuring over there?
That's an understatement.
What are you gonna kayak through the fjords? Are you gonna scale some mountains?
I don't think we'll do kayaking. We'll do a lot of hiking. We'll do a lot of walking. Mm. Tina and I.
You
run.
And your best friend, right?
My best friend is who I'm staying with.
Pretty cool.
Yep. And we're gonna. She actually comes out again to see me in November too. So we haven't seen each other like this kind of. Close in proximity. So yeah, we did a lot.
Yeah, last time, if I'm not mistaken, she was on a pack walk with
us,
right?
She went with
back
us
in
the
day.
Walk, yep.
Like that was like 3 years ago or something ago. Like that. So I'm really excited for you, really happy
you.
For you. I'm hoping to get some really nice October weather. That's kind of why I scheduled it, because
October is the best month ever anywhere.
But in Nola, it's really special.
Perfect, yeah.
It's really special. So that, I'll be gone, Laura will be gone, everybody will be kind of like traipsing back and forth. But what does that mean for Q&A Saturday is the big $1,000 question.
Yeah.
So we're working on some ideas. Just real quick, I know we're getting a little long in the tooth here, but just wanted to share with you guys all the stuff going on. We're going to try and find a way to keep Q&A Saturday going.
Yep.
We've got some creative, fun ideas. I think there might be some cool stuff that we get into that might be really, really fun.
Yeah.
So looking forward to getting that going on. I'm going to be working really hard on the book. While I'm down there, really trying to shore it all up, get the foreword together, and then really try and construct a lot of the... I'm going to go over all the stuff that's already... all the other content that's already in existence. I'm going to go over it and redo a lot of it, and then add some new stuff that you guys have never seen before. We've got a reshoot for the DVD. So which is good news for you guys because it means there'll be extra special stuff in it, but that means I have to fly out from Nola to do a reshoot, kind of rock star style. I think a helicopter is going to pick me up from the airport, and then I'm going to like parachute down and then like start working with dogs, and then like
just like they'll just suck you up back.
And then like a car pulls up like in a marked car and they throw me in and off I go. So we've got a reshoot going on, just a short one, but there's some stuff we really want to make sure is in the DVD, so bear with us as it takes a little time to get there. All that said, we're very excited for you guys to be watching us, hanging out with us. Every week, it feels like it's been months since we do this. That's just because we enjoy it and we miss you guys.
Yeah,
I think we should jump into the show.
If, my dear,
you are ready for me to jump into the show.
Please do.
Hey, everybody. It's Sean from The Good Dog. And this soon-to-be Nordic princess is the lovely Laura Morgan, who will be like picturing like snowshoes, like traipsing across, and she's gonna work with me here, right? Snowshoes and I picture like a herd of reindeer, and you'll be like maybe you'll be on like a little sled.
Yeah.
Let's get rid of the snowshoes. You'll be on a little sled, and then like just across the frozen tundra.
Right.
You got to find some frozen tundra, though, in the fall.
Right.
So, anyways, so, and all this good stuff, which you can't see,
it's all this good stuff in the mind. You know, there's nothing good around. I mean, this is great.
There's a lot of good stuff here. There's Belle, there's Manny, there's Cijo, there's Hercules, the table dweller, there's Junior, the elderly guy. All this stuff, this joint, this environment, the magic that comes from here is the Good Dogs Q&A Saturday, episode number 48. Get him up, lady.
Wow, look at
Get
you.
Him up, lady, right? Who's been practicing? I don't want to hear any...
Nail's broken. Do it again. 48.
I don't want to hear any more guff from you about my ineptitude when it comes to math. You ready to jump?
Ready?
As Van Halen said, might as well jump. I'm excited, but I'm also sad. This is like, it's kind of the last time that we're going to be working together for
a long time.
Yeah, multiple weeks.
I think, honestly, we came to the conclusion that this is the longest that you and I will be apart in 4 years.
I need a tissue.
Don't say that when you're saying it, like...
I'm sad. Oh. No, I'm...
You're actually sad.
Why would you be on the defense?
Because you're like...
That?
I need a tissue.
I'm serious. I'm not going to see you for, well, unless you show up in Nola, you know, towards the end. This is the longest we've ever, like, not hung out.
I mean, I'll see you in Portland. That's in a month. Oh, yeah. And I'll also see you when you come up for the reshoot.
Okay, so we'll be seeing each other every week. Forget all that. I don't need my tissue. I'm okay. But it is, you know, like you were saying, you're going to miss the dogs. You're going to miss Doodles and all those guys. Yeah. So. All right.
Okay. Question number one.
Boy, was that a long intro. Yeah.
Simi Lion says, at what age would you introduce a Great Pyrenees puppy to an e-collar for basic obedience training in open fields? Mm-hmm. Keep in mind, this is going to be a 100-pound dog and they are free thinkers.
Okay, so is it samey or?
Samey.
It's, what's that dash called over the E?
I don't know.
Okay, so.
Accent.
Okay, so samey or seamy, what I'd suggest is, you know, 4 months old is a pretty doable age to get into e-collar work. We've done several dogs that are 4 months old. Purple. If you do a little search on our YouTube page, you'll see Purple was a Wheaton Terrier, and she came in. She started a board and train at like 3 months old, I think, with Jeff out in Rhode Island, at his other location, not his Norwegian location, and just for like basic puppy training and stuff like that, and then came out here, and we did a full e-collar board and train, and she was a rock star. At 4 months, I've like never seen a pup so well trained and so awesome. It was really, really cool to see. And I think for a lot of people that think that e-collars just shut dogs down and make them miserable, like if you watch that Purple video, it's pretty hard to feel negative about an e-collar. She's just flying around having a good time. So obviously that entails doing it, you know, really slow, really fair, being really caring and I'm gonna say cautious, but yes, cautious about how you introduce it. Make sure that you're really just take your time and make sure it's a good experience for the pup. And I was gonna say prior to doing the e-collar work, just teach everything with just teach everything with food and leash. Teach everything with food or leash and prong, right? That's what I'm trying to say. I got like, so
just for them to get with the
So what I don't want you to do is I don't want you to like start teaching e-collar training just, you know, au naturel, just without any foundation. So what we do with puppies here is like just use food, teach sit, down, place, have them drag a little leash around, right? All the food stuff starts really nice positive associations, gets the dog motivated, gets them really understanding all the behaviors. And then what I'd probably do is then I'd move to leash and prong and make sure that the dog has a little bit more like compliance, right? So we start off really soft for the pup, and then we start adding leash and prong for a little more compliance, a little more non-negotiability, and make sure that they respond to pressure in a really nice way. And then we can go to the e-collar, and you've laid such a nice foundation that you should be able to just take off like that. So that would be my approach if it was a pup coming to me, even a headstrong one. Like, let's get into food. Let's start nice and easy. Let's get that rocking. Then let's go to leash and prong, and then let's go to e-collar. And the only thing I would say, I would change leash and prong and advance that over food is if you've got like a dog who's being like a major pain in the rear and is like spoiled and entitled and the food is making things worse, and then you could just go to leash and prong. But I think what I shared with you should work really nicely.
Yeah.
Anything to add to that for Simi?
I think that's pretty good. That's basically what I would say.
Food, leash
food,
and prong.
Leash and prong.
E-collar.
Yeah. And move to e-collar.
Yeah, and we're saying like 4 months, right? I mean, depends what age.
The dog's gonna be bigger, and
It depends what age, you know, you get the dog at. But if you get the dog at like 8 to 12 weeks, you know, that's 3 months old. Do a nice month of like prep, And then jump into e-collar work, and like next thing you know, you got a rock star dog, even with a strong, willful 100,000-pound Pyrenees. So, all right.
Thank you.
Hope that helps.
Question number two, this is from Shauna.
Shauna.
Shauna asks, hi, Sean. How do I introduce dog to water who's never been exposed to water before?
Oy.
I took both of my foster doggies to the doggy water park this week.
Mm-hmm.
I'm especially concerned about Dylan the blind chihuahua. How do I introduce him to water? Mm. He was nervous and frightened. He's doing much better with the aggressive behavior. He played with the other dogs at the water park and wasn't aggressive with them. Is this Dylan the one that Jeff answered the question? It was that aggressive blind chihuahua. And remember?
Good question.
I think so.
It might be.
Yeah, he was like, it was kind of like, he was like, he's not being a good dog because he's being aggressive.
Right.
Cool. So he's less reactive to cats and dogs. That's great. However, there's more work to do because he's still reactive and aggressive sometimes. Also, the structured walk was suggested for him, but I don't know what that is or how to do it, which is, that's an easy fix. So let's just talk about the water one.
The good news is, I think it was Jacqueline.
Andrea
underneath.
Yep.
She was like, here's what the structured walk is. And bam, 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 laid it out and like helped her out. So we got lots of backups. So that's pretty cool. All right. So water stuff. I've taught a lot of dogs to swim, and there's a bunch of different ways to do it. Like Jeff Gelman does it definitely a different way than me. Some would call it the lazy way because he never has to get in the pool or get wet. Typically what I do, so there's like two methods that I would use. With a chihuahua, I might just like have it on leash and make sure it's got a collar that it can't slip out of, like a martingale or something. And then I would get into the water and I would slowly acclimate the dog to the water, and I'd support the dog like this with its hand under the belly. Because what happens is a lot of dogs get in water and they panic. Yeah. And then what happens is instead of them dog paddling like this, they go splash, 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 and then they go like the Titanic, just down like that. So if you can just stick with them and just, you know, I'll typically use the leash like this, their heads here, and then my hand here under their belly, and just kind of guide them along until they get out of that panic mode, until they realize the mechanics of how to keep themselves stable. Mm-hmm. So that's one way to start. The other way to start with bigger dogs, which is what I more typically do, is leash and prong on. I get into the pool. Usually there's a set of steps. You say you're at a water park, so I don't know what the hell that looks like. But I'm in the pool, and I'm going to use gentle leash pressure. And typically you're going to have dogs that are worried, fearful, freaked out about, like, I don't want to go in. And so you don't just like toss them in. You don't just yank them in. But it's gentle, consistent leash pressure. You get the dog right to the first step. He's going to be like, no, no, no. A little bit more pressure. Dog makes a step in, relax the leash, but don't let him jump out. When I say relax it, I mean just let go of a little bit of the tension. Don't like let it go. And then you slowly guide the dog further and further until the dog makes the next step where they actually launch off the step, and then they start going. Now, once again, you're probably going to get panic stuff. No matter what dog it is, they typically, I mean, you can have an exception, but they typically, they freak, they panic. And so they dog paddle real frantically and their legs kick and they don't do any of the stuff right. And then they go into this mode. So once again, your job, leash. And this time you'd have the leash and prong, and then guide like this. I don't know if I can do it. I don't want to like hit you in the head here, but it would look like you're the dog. Like, here's your ears. Oh, good boy. And it would be like this leash. And then I would hold, like, back legs would be here. And I'd just like guide like this. And that way the dog starts to get its equilibrium in the water and like, oh, okay, I know how to keep myself together. Mm-hmm. But I'll keep moving, right? You want to keep moving. Don't just stand there. Like, I mean, you let them paddle, let them go through the panic, let them get their sea legs. But once they do that, really you want to start moving. And then eventually you want to fade this hand once they're able to hold themselves stable. And then you want to guide them around with the leash. Don't get them too close to the edge or they'll panic and try and get out over the edge. Just keep directing them with the leash and guide them around. Don't let them get too close to you, because what happens a lot of times is they'll panic and they'll scratch you up a lot, unless you got a wetsuit on. So just guide them around, get them into a good space, and what you should see is, I don't want to go in the water, I'm scared, finally I'm in the water. Now I'm panicking in the water. I'm helping the dog through it. Now I'm relaxed and I'm swimming and dog paddling. Now I'm guiding around the pool. And then what I'll do over and over and over again is bring the dog over to the steps and out and teach them how to get out of the pool. Okay. But I do not take them over to get out of the pool until the dog is calm and cool and chilled. I don't want to take a panicky, freaked out dog, and try and lead them out, because I don't want, I don't want the last thing that just happened being like, I'm freaked out about the pool. I want them to go through the process, be like, oh, this isn't so bad. And then we say, cool, here's how you get out. And then you do it exactly, you do it right away again. Boom, back into the pool. You should get less resistance this time. You should get less panic. You should get less resistance pulling them in, less panic once they get in, and they should be more comfortable kind of swimming around, do some laps, bring them back out to the steps when they're calm. Out they go, and do it over and over again. Next thing you know, the dog's like, oh, cool. And they're jumping in the water and doing their thing. So that's how I typically do it. The other way, like I said, is to carry, like if it's a real small dog, you carry it in and then like kind of go through this process, but I'd still have a leash on and I'd still support and I'd still do everything else I just said. Make sure, I was just gonna add this one little addendum, make sure that the dog park, the water park, which I don't even know anything about a dog water park. I've never seen one.
Or like a dog park with water.
Yeah, be careful. Yeah. Be careful that it's a valuable, positive experience for your dog.
Especially if, that dog, Dylan.
If you've got stressed out dogs, like I get the idea of like, let's help them have fun with water and see if we can help them, you know, build confidence. Mm-hmm. But if they're around a bunch of strange dogs and it's making them nervous and insecure, that's not where I'd put them. Mm-hmm. Have them swim in a pool if you want to have them swim or something like that. But I certainly wouldn't be bringing insecure, aggressive, unstable dogs into a situation with a population of dogs I don't really know. Mm-hmm. So that's an extra little piece of the puzzle. And that's what I have to say about that. Want to add anything?
That was all great.
You like the wetsuit, non-wet? Yeah, I go cool. Non-wetsuit. I'm like,
got to.
I'm au naturel. I'm like Jacques Cousteau. You don't know who that is.
No.
That's right.
Like, is he a server?
So this is a good moment where you can superimpose Jacques Cousteau for everybody to learn.
Great. If I didn't have 3 hours to cut this entire show.
You can do it. You're like a superhero. All you have to do is go Jacques Cousteau on Google. Boing. He comes up. You like superimpose it.
The truth is sometimes I don't watch the whole show through because it's 2 hours of footage.
Part of it. Well, we're going to have to do a little bit more thorough research.
Okay.
Oh, AC. Sad to see you go.
Nine. Plots.
Right. What are you doing? How are you going to assist here? All right. If you can, like, not mess everything up, you can stay right here. You guys can't see this.
You should just see my apartment and know that what you just said is never going to happen. What? I just went to Starbucks with my gift card from Donna Cram, by the way. Thank you so much, Donna.
Aww, Donna, thanks.
For my birthday, she sent me a Starbucks gift card. I went up there to pay for our stuff, handed the card, and it's like a bite marks all over it. Like it's destroyed. The guy has to like punch in the number. It's not Hercules. It's the 9-year-old dog.
C-Jo. All right. C-Jo, take it easy. I got work to do here, buddy.
Question number 3. This is from Kate.
Yep.
Kate says, I know I'm late for the party, but I was hoping to get insight this week.
Never too late, Kate.
Okay, here it is. My dog's... I have an 11-month-old super dog people-friendly pit boxer and a 6-year-old bull terrier / Jack Russell. Yep. We live in the city and our backyard is separated from the neighbor's yard by a chain link fence. There are 8 dogs in the building next door, all of which are friends with my dogs except one giant, anxious, unwalked, untrained shepherd mix named Jack. He routinely rushes the fence since his owners let him out unleashed. Cujo.
Can we maybe place him somewhere?
Okay. Plots.
Like...
Just put him down.
Cujo. Are we going to put him down?
Just... No.
Oh, sorry.
All right. So...
He just doesn't seem to be able to
hold
himself.
I'll move him after I finish this. He has routinely rushed the fence since the owners let him out unleashed.
Yeah.
He's pinned every dog in the complex, but not Goodness. Put any holes in them. He's broken his owner's collarbone, dragging her towards other dogs. He's seriously troubled.
Wow.
Anyway, my pit bull Margot was caught by surprise by his initial fence outburst and now feels on guard in the yard. She never redirects or tries to put up a fight when I veer her away.
Yep.
But do you think higher levels on the e-collar would help or hurt? When she hears them start up, she goes deaf to the recall, so we've been trying to strengthen that. She's e-collar trained, but she's the type of dog who freezes to think for a moment when corrected, which keeps her in proximity with Jack. I'll move him. Okay. I told you he's so strong.
Gujo, you're supposed to be a team player here, buddy. All right, guys, hang on. Don't knock anything over. Good boy. Okay. All right, Kate, I wrote a few notes for you just because I want to make sure we get this right and help you knock this out of the park. Okay, so that dog sounds like a real rat bastard. Yeah, what Laura said. Okay, so here we go. Regardless of distraction, regardless of what's going on, regardless of how nasty that other dog is, regardless of the fence fighting intensity, you should still be able to call your dog off. I don't care what's cooking. That's how e-collars work. If they're used properly, you should be able to get your dog back no matter what. So I want you to kind of shift your thinking away from like he gets deaf when he's, you know, at the fence and doesn't listen to recall. The reason he doesn't listen to recall is because his mind is so intense about the fence fighting and the pressure you're using from the e-collar and is just not nearly enough to be valuable for him or valuable enough for him to prioritize what you're looking for. So hold on to what I just said right there because that's the whole enchilada, right? Intense state of mind, not intense enough correction, not going to hear it, right? Mm-hmm. So what I'd like you to do is do a much higher level pop, right? So your dog runs over to the fence. I don't know what you're correcting at. Let's say you're on a mini educator and you're correcting at 25, and typically that works really great. What I would probably do is your dog runs over to the fence and starts acting the fool. I'd do like a 65, 70, something like that. Just pop. And you can share a no, but your dog probably won't even hear the verbal. But just the pop to like whew, for a reset, clear the cobwebs, get your dog focused. And once it's an amazing thing when you think about like two-part kind of like addressing or corrections. Like we used to have to do this, I remember with Polar Bear, and we had to do this when he was crazy about like not fence fighting, but window fighting and stuff like that. And that's like boom. And the first big boom correction has to be enough to like clear the mind. Yeah. And then once the mind's clear, you can say, come. And then whatever you want to do, right? So I'd love to give you permission to not feel bad, not feel guilty, not feel uncomfortable about correcting your dog more highly for this shenanigans, because yes, that dog's misbehaving, but let's ask your dog to be like the awesome ambassador that doesn't. And to be honest, you could actually prevent your dog from even engaging in this, right? So we've got like a couple of different concepts. We can like correct high, clear the cobwebs, and then recall your dog away. Or we can correct maybe even higher and not even recall him away and just let your dog know every time you're by the fence and you get nutty like that, big consequence. And what you'll probably see is your dog will start to avoid going over to that fence and avoid going in and having that interaction in general, right? So there's two kind of concepts, right? So they both involve some higher level corrections. One involves like you doing a little bit more management or recalling the dog away, and you'll hear a lot of trainers say that, but I'm a big believer and a big fan of getting dogs to do their best work. And you share some firmer corrections, like, and let your dog tell you what those correction levels are, but you share some firmer corrections for just being nutty around that fence, and you're consistently, like, you watch through the window or from your porch or whatever, your dog will go, man, that fence is hot, I don't want to be anywhere near it, even though, like, Mr. Jackass himself is over there, like, provoking me, I'm gonna fight the good fight, I'm gonna move away from that. So those are my big recommendations for you. Yeah, let your dog tell you what level works. That's always the golden rule, right? So your dog's not deaf. Your dog just isn't motivated enough to listen, right? So your dog can hear you, most likely can hear you, but the noise in the head is saying like it's not valuable enough to listen to. So don't get caught on a number. Just watch your dog, right? So if I can visualize your dog at the fence and your dog is my dog and it's going crazy, I would just roll up, pop, and I would just be watching my dog. And as soon as I roll up and pop, and maybe it's 70, maybe it's 80, and my dog goes, "Aah!" and then backs away, cool, now we got a good thing going on. Now I have that choice. Do I recall him away? I dial back down if I'm going to recall him away if I need to. Or let him make another choice. What choice do you make? Oh, you go back to the fence. Pop. Arr! Crap, that's a bad choice. I don't want to be over there. And then you start to see your dog do his own best work of not putting himself in that situation. That's where your fence is, by the way, over there. Not get into that situation and manage himself and do his best work. So what you're struggling with is typical with what 9 out of 10 owners struggle with, which is underwhelming the dog with the corrective level. And that's cool. And that's why, like, it's such a funny thing. You know, so many people harp on, you know, like e-collar training is being really bad. People are going to just cook their dog. All I see over and over and over again are people being like very conscientious and very concerned and very worried about overcorrecting. Mm-hmm. So I think that's all a bunch of hooey about, like, people are just going out, yeah, let's see how it goes. And people care about their dogs and they're trying to do good work. So anyways, that said, find a level that matters to your dog. And the way you know it matters is because you'll see behavior change with your dog. You can knock this out, bam, like that. Have the best dog in that backyard where all the other dogs being acting the fool and your dog's like, man, I don't act the fool. I got better things to do. Right? Anything to add? No? Miss Norway? All right. That's it.
Question number 4. This is from Aaron Marsden. Aaron says, hi guys, I'm back again with another question, only a short one this time. I just want to start off.
Is it really a short one?
Oh, is this an update? No. Oh, I guess. Just want to start off letting you guys know that my previously leashed reactive Dane is amazing. We have so long ways to go, but so much more pleasant. We even passed by 2 not so savory dogs who were leashed and lunging, barking, going mental. My girl who's off leash and she didn't even bat an eye.
Awesome.
In your personal opinion, here's the question. What would be the first thing you would teach a new puppy besides teaching the name? And in your experience, what is the minimum age you would start a puppy on either e-collar or prong? My partner want to add a second Dane to my girl's second birthday and was curious to your answer. This puppy will be raised the right way this time around.
The right way.
Feel more knowledgeable.
I like it. Okay. Aaron, what to teach the new puppy? So first of all, awesome update. Like, nice work.
Yeah.
You got to love people going out and doing this hard work and, like, doing it on their own. Yeah. I'm always enamored with you guys doing
amazing
that stuff. Yeah. Okay. So what would I teach? I don't know if there's like a first thing that I would teach. What I would do is I teach all the basics, right? It's so simple, right? Just use food. I don't mean so simple to be condescending. What I mean is, like, it's keep it really simple. It's not like, oh man, if I teach sit first or place first, there's like a big value, you know, difference.
Yeah.
Teach sit, down, place, come, and let your dog drag a leash around. You can even, like, walk around with the leash a little bit in the house, you know, if he's really young. But use food for all that stuff, right? So let me just check. Teach sit, down, place, come with food. Yep, so that's totally covered. And hopefully you know how to do that, right? So sit, down, place, recall. All that stuff, we're just using the food to lure. And I don't think I have any videos showing how to lure, but it's a pretty simple process of just, like, if you really think about it, like, you want to sit, you raise the food, like, right above your dog's nose, and then you hold it, and the dog's butt hits the ground, and then good, and then, you know, feed the dog down like that, you know, come, you can have a little leash on and, like, you know, feed and do stuff like that. So that's what I'd start off with. Yeah. It's just really simple. Have fun, you know, like, don't make it too regimented and too much of, like, like in the army, but make sure, nothing against army folks, just make sure that you're just getting those basics taught so the dog has an understanding of, like, what this word means and the behavior that corresponds with it. And then as far as leash and prong, probably 3 to 4 months for prong, depending on the dog. I think she said Danes, right?
Yep.
Yep. So Danes are big. So mm-hmm. if at 3 months you already have like a pulling, like slightly nutty Dane,
yeah.
then I would put the prong on at 3 months. If the Dane's like pretty mellow and docile and you're not having too much trouble with it, I might wait until 4 months if I don't need it. For me, it's like, when do I need it? Mm-hmm. And so we put prongs on dogs at 3 months. I don't think we've ever put prongs on dogs at like 2 months, anything like that. But 3 months to 4 months is a good.
It's a good bet.
And then e-collar, probably around 4 to 5 months, mm-hmm. right? So let's get all the prongs solid. So we start with, we kind of answered this question with somebody else earlier, right? So start with the food, then go to leash and prong. I think we said between 3 and 4 months. Mm-hmm. And then the only caveat with that is if you've got a maniac, then start at 3 months with leash and prong. Like literally, if you've got a maniac, do some food work early, then get the leash and prong on at 3 months, and then at 4 months, do e-collar work. If you got a more casual, easy, relaxed dog, you can probably push that back a little bit, and you could do leash and prong 3 to 4, and then like e-collar 4 to 5 months, something like that. Mm-hmm. And if you do that, you're going to have yourself a pretty freaking awesome dog.
So starting the right way.
Yeah. I hope that covers all the ins and outs of that. But there's always a lot of resistance to doing e-collar or prong work early on.
Yeah.
And what we see a lot of is young dogs dragging people around and actually like doing more damage to themselves on flat buckle collars because they're strong and they're pulling, like some of these pitties or Danes or big breeds, but they're young. But yeah, they're like they're pulling themselves around. I'd much rather have a prong on a dog when we start seeing that stuff and get the dog into a nice easy mode where walks are a piece of cake and we've already like knocked that out.
Yeah.
So hopefully that covers that.
That. All right. Have Thanks. Fun with that puppy.
Yeah. She's not doing it yet, right?
Not yet.
She's just getting her. She's gathering her info.
Yes.
Excellent.
Well, we'd love a picture when you do get that puppy because I'm sure it's going to be cute.
Yeah. Please. Thanks.
Thanks. Nine. Just say any word, and he's like, "Oh,
it's time to go."
We haven't run lately because of the heat.
Yeah.
Because I took him out once, and he was like dying.
Yeah.
And so I'm like,
he's an old timer.
Gotta be careful.
He's an old timer.
Question number 5. This is from Addie. Addie says, "Hi, I'm new to your Facebook page, but I'm addicted." Oh.
Addie, welcome.
"I have a rescued lab, 2-year-old male. He's e-collar trained and I've had him only a year.
Mm-hmm.
I've worked with 3 trainers. The most recent told me she's stumped with him. He's a very nervous, anxious guy and as a result, dog reactive and aggressive. He walks great at home and has all the obedience, sit, place, recall, etc. But in new environments has a lot of trouble focusing on anything but being frantic, sniffing, pulling, weaving, tripping me, cutting between my legs, etc. I think duration work is what he needs because the walk is just not happening. Can you give me an idea on how to start? How do I need to make him lay down? Do I need to start with 15 minutes? You know, does he need to lay down until he relaxes? That could be a while. Is this something I could master at home before moving to the park? Will it change his state of mind with walking, etc.? When I walk him constantly using the e-collar to remind him to heal, he won't keep the position."
Okay. So, Addie, great question.
Yeah.
Welcome to the party. We're happy to have you here, and I'm glad you're enjoying the Facebook page and the videos and all that good stuff. So duration work's awesome, right? Duration work, you hear us yap about it all the time, and I probably posted about something about it last week or something like that. But I want to be careful to be clear and make the distinction that doing duration work is a piece of a puzzle or a piece of the puzzle and is helpful, but I don't think duration work is going to help fix this problem. Mm-hmm. This problem is a walk-specific problem. Now, everything else you do in the house is going to help contribute to giving you leverage to doing a better job, but just like doing like 1,000 years of duration work is probably not going to sort out that intensity.
Right.
It might help a little bit, right? Definitely, I would definitely be doing it, but I wouldn't look to that to be your panacea that's going to really like sort all that stuff out, right?
Yeah.
So that's first things first. I wrote you some notes. So I'm going to run down through the notes for you. So First of all, I'd be curious if you're using a prong collar with your dog. A lot of dogs have been taught on e-collar for heel and all the other behaviors aren't taught to use a prong collar simultaneously. So a lot of trainers don't use prong collars and e-collars. I think a lot of people feel like it's overkill and all this stuff. And if he's e-collar trained, why does he need it? But I'm telling you, as a crew that uses prong and e-collar on every dog that goes through board and train, you take that prong collar off and you will notice dramatic differences in choices. The amount of tuned in, focused, connected, I know that my handler has got like a real like, you know, connection, like a close physical connection to me. Yep. Yeah. Rather than like he's got an e-collar, but he's got me on a flat buckle collar.
Right.
That gives a lot of room to like move and groove and zigzag. All those things you're talking about tells me that's a dog that doesn't know how to heel very well and is not feeling very certain about that activity, right? So first thing, add a prong collar if you don't have a prong collar. Prong collar goes on top. You can use a smaller or medium. Then your e-collar goes in the middle. And then underneath that goes your flat buckle collar. And if you're really savvy, you'll watch our videos and you'll put a carabiner over from the prong collar to the flat buckle, call it the e-collar sandwich. E-collar's in the middle, right? So you might be surprised just by putting a prong collar on your dog, if you don't already have one, what kind of changes in demeanor and choices and behavior you see. It's dramatic. I watch it all the time. Even when we put dogs that are on dominant dog collars, because they have problems with prong stuff, they do well, but they push boundaries more because that like that reminder isn't there. You know what I mean? That just that kind of like sensory reminder
isn't
there.
Doesn't mean they'll be forever, but just at the start, you know, you guys haven't had the greatest start, so.
Yeah, but so for me, like everything you're talking about, that sounds like a willy-nilly, wild and crazy walk. That does not sound like an immaculate heel, right? Mm-hmm. So add a prong collar with your e-collar for walks. Do it just like I explained, and then you need to cultivate an immaculate heel. And a lot of people, like even a lot of trainers, will teach loose leash walking even with e-collars, and I'm totally against it. We're totally against it. We've watched dog after dog after dog after dog with more looseness on that walk misbehave, become more aroused, target other dogs, get into trouble because they're not as connected to you and they're not as accountable for a behavior and a position that you're looking for. You ask a dog to be in a position like our heel is like the head is parallel with the hip and you cannot move from that. And if you ask for that strict of a position from a dog, that takes so much brain power and so much work that there's so little left to go like snotty and get into trouble, right? So
it's a working walk.
Very highly structured. Yeah. My suspicion would be is that that's not what your walk looks like, right? So if we were getting zigzagging, sniffing, right? I mean, imagine if you were to take a board
that's
and train
like
dog
a before
out.
Videos.
Right.
Yeah.
That's what happens before they're e-collar trained and before they understand the rules of what that looks like. So not to like be negative, but I'd suggest that either the training that you got or the way you interpret it, some pieces are missing for your dog. For some dogs, it might be cool, but for a lot of dogs, prong collar, e-collar, and then very specific position, that dog goes down like literally. So two commands, heel for position, you move forward, tap the button at a valuable level, heel, dog should come back. Dog drags, heel. Dog comes out that way, heel. Dog tries to sniff, no. Dog tries to target and look at another dog? No. Dog gets aroused? No. And all of these are with corrections, right? So basically we're saying, stop doing this, stop pulling out in front, stop dragging, stop sniffing, be present with me, walk like this. But you only get that by you cultivating it. You only get that by saying, like, it's almost like you got this clay pot and you're like, you know, if I'm getting into a weird analogy here, but like if you're trying to mold or sculpture, I would say, and you're trying to get this beautiful thing, you have to chip away at all of the edges that don't work until you end up with the thing that looks beautiful. So my suspicion is that you've got kind of a loosey-goosey walk, and if you were to show up here at nine and a loosey-goosey downstay. My suspicion is if you were to show up here, sorry, we got Cujo moving in on me. we could probably rectify that pretty quickly. So what I'd do is I'd look at some of our videos of what that e-collar heel looks like with a prong collar. And then my last final notes for you would be short leash. First thing we tell our clients, excuse me, is he going to chew a bone that whole time?
Oh, it's not good?
No, because it's going to be like noisy. It actually picks up pretty loud. Sorry, Cooch. So short leash, right? That means I go against what a lot of other people say, the dog's leash should be loose. No, I want a short leash. So the moment the dog gets distracted, pulls, drags, sniffs, anything, you know it right away and you correct right away. First thing, grab the leash really short. Prong, exact heel position, valuable corrections for pulling, zigzagging, sniffing, ears up, targeting. Keep it simple, and you should have yourself a very different walk. I would say that other trainer is stumped because they're not doing that, and they're trying to work with an aroused dog, which is what happens when you give them too much freedom and looseness. Now you're correcting bigger moments rather than little moments. I hope that makes a lot of sense, because that's like, that's the magic stuff, right? You don't go after these little moments. You've got a dog who's aroused and you're trying to correct for big moments. Good luck. That's going to be big trouble. So that is my very lengthy, long, detailed answer. But if you follow it and watch our videos, it's crystal clear and our clients do extremely well with it. So that is that. Come on, Norwegian princess. Are you gonna bring your parka?
She has stuff for me there.
You don't, so that means you won't, I have a hard time believing you won't bring a parka.
Of course I'll bring
a parka. You always bring a parka, right? Okay.
I'm just so excited. Like, you think fall, I mean, fall here is nice.
Yeah.
Fall in Nola is like perfect.
Yeah.
Fall in Norway is pretty nice.
Probably magical.
It's pretty magical.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because it's getting colder, though. It's starting to, like,
yeah,
you know.
So, but you're getting, like, just, like, the hint.
Mm-hmm.
But Norway's maybe one of the most beautiful countries in the world.
And like, where I go is Bergen.
You're going to Bergen, yeah.
Yeah. Like, yeah. Mountains, and it's all, like, if you go to Oslo, it's a little bit, I don't want to say flat, but it's a little bit more flat, a little bit, you know, city. You've got,
yep.
It's still everywhere in Norway is gorgeous.
Yep.
But Bergen's really known for, like, being super mountainous, super rainy, very, like, dramatic weather,
yeah.
A lot
yeah.
of that stuff. It's a lot darker and a lot colder, but it, but man.
Special.
Special.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And to be there with my best friend, I simply
yeah,
can't wait.
Yeah, I'm happy for you.
Any
okay. family going to be over there?
Yeah, I have family there.
Mm-hmm. Anybody that's going or just family that lives there?
Family that lives there.
Okay.
Yep.
Great.
Yep. Okay. Question 6. This is from Karen. Karen says, first
yes.
off, thank you for the free videos. They've been amazing
welcome,
learning
welcome,
tools
welcome,
for
welcome.
Me to use in my dog. We have a year-old multi-mix of God knows what, 60-pound dog named Wally.
Wally.
He's pretty awesome. He's fabulous on leash. He's great with our dogs and wonderful with our little human kids.
Yeah.
The last area to conquer with Wally is his fear around men. We never know what man may spook him.
Mm.
He was and is well socialized since we got him at 9 weeks old around people, places, and things.
Mm-hmm.
When weather appropriate, he goes everywhere with us.
Nice.
He's more of a reserved kind of guy, and that's okay. For some reason, he's scared of death of my brother-in-law.
B.I.L.
My Billy, yeah. My B.I.L. is 6'7", so maybe his height is freaking him out. I don't know.
I'd be scared.
But Wally actively, avoids him.
Yeah.
One time Wally was nearby, brother-in-law went in to pet Wally, and Wally showed teeth. This was right after I got the e-collar, and this is the exact behavior.
Is he, like, smiling for a Colgate commercial?
This is the exact behavior, and his lack of consistent
Sorry.
Listening outside that started me on the quest to get his behavior on point, because showing teeth is not acceptable.
Right.
Wow, this is a long question.
Yeah.
Okay.
You
so
don't have to get into the whole thing.
Basically, yeah, he's deathly afraid of the male vet. The females he's good with.
He bit somebody when they were trying to put the collar on
he
at the vet.
Nipped a worker. Yeah. Okay.
That's the last time. So yeah. I know she's Karen's really concerned about that. The cool thing is that brother-in-law is really happy to work with him and wants
yeah.
to get him over the hump. So
and we own an e-collar and prong collar.
Yeah.
So yeah.
super duper awesome.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I don't know how well trained the dog is, but
yeah.
I'm hoping we got some good stuff going on. So once again, I wrote some notes for you, Miss Karen, to make sure that I get you some good stuff. So first thing, have all men ignore him? I don't want any pressure put on Wally to be pet in the context of just like, let me make friends with you. Mm-hmm. I just put a post up with Marley, who's going home in just a couple days, and Marley was deathly afraid of men, and same behavior, smaller dog, but nipping, growling, lunging, and biting people. And how did we get him to not do that? We got him to be like, highly structured, highly accountable, all e-collar work, recalling, working with men, all that stuff, almost zero affection, treating him very much like a real dog and demanding a lot of him, right? So that's something to really think about. But I didn't try and make his, I didn't try and become his friend. I didn't like sit in front of his crate and offer him chicken and be like, buddy, me and you, let's build a bridge. I said, literally, if he wouldn't come out of his crate, I'd roll his crate up, like, time to come out. Stuff that would make, I think, most people think that's going to damage and undermine your relationship, like that firmness, that non-negotiability of, like, you need to come out. It's non-negotiable. Instead of it doing that, all it did was build a relationship, and it's very counter to what a lot of people think. So that's one piece of it. What I'd love you to do, if you've got some real e-collar training going on, is have brother-in-law do a bunch of work with Wally, which is like recall, sit, down, place. Mm-hmm. It's so cool with remote collar stuff because you can run it and brother-in-law just has to be cool and do the commands and imitate, emulate you and sound fairly normal when he does it, right? So the most powerful one you can do is recall. The most powerful thing you can make a fearful dog do, and I did a ton of it with Marley, is recall to me. Recall to me. Because what does Marley want to do? Go the opposite way. Mm-hmm. Go the opposite way. And the psychological shift is that for Marley or for Wally is that you're not grabbing him with a leash and yanking him in. Your brother-in-law is not like, get over here and let's be friends. You're running the remote. Your brother-in-law is giving commands. And Wally is having to come to him to turn off the pressure on the e-collar. But what happens psychologically is Wally goes, holy crap, I'm doing this. Yep. No one's forcing me. What am I doing? Like, here I am walking towards this thing I'm nervous about, which helps really build confidence over time. So I'd ask your brother-in-law to use really soft body language because he's so big, like kneeling down sideways, right? You don't want him standing up in his 6-foot grand shirts too much. So he's got to kneel down sideways, like mm-hmm. like if Laura was the dog, it would be like this, right? And then easy voice commands. If he's got a deep voice, he's got to be real mellow, really like kind of neutral with that. So anyways, have your brother work with him. You run the remote. Dog doesn't know who's got the remote. Doesn't matter. Help him work through that. If you need a long line on him to help guide him, but mainly using knee collar pressure, do so. I don't want your brother trying to engage, even if he does recall into him. No touching, petting, or like, let's be friends. Mm-hmm. Like, hard to get. Just make him work, right? Brother-in-law and the dog. Just recall, sit down, place, do this, do this, do this, do this. And what you'll find is that Wally will start working with your brother and feeling differently about him because your brother's demanding this stuff of him, but he's not demanding acceptance of pressure, acceptance of like, let me touch you, let me be friends, let me come closer to you, all those things that unnerve the dog. So that's really, really important. And then something else really valuable if you want to add into that, and I don't know what your lifestyle looks like as far as how often brother-in-law's over, but if you could, if he's there like in the neighborhood and he could come over every day, brother-in-law's the only one who feeds him and he feeds him out of his hand. Like that's how we can like really build stuff with dogs that are like really freaked out is, and like I said, I didn't do that with Marley, but because I didn't need to, but if you've got a really severe case, if the only way the dog eats is through brother-in-law's hand, the association that starts to build is a really positive one. Mm-hmm. Now, that said, your dog, Wally's very likely to say, I don't want to eat because, you know, this is too uncomfortable for me. But if brother-in-law's around a lot, then you try the next day and you try the next day. But it's also in conjunction with him working with the dog. He's not just sitting there trying to say, like, come over, you know, he's recalling him. Come, dog comes over, offers some food, doesn't want it, cool, we put it away.
Yeah.
Try again the next day. Now, if you don't have the ability to have the brother-in-law over there every day, then the next choice would be is before he does come over, when you know he's going to visit, don't feed Wally the day before. Let him get really hungry and see if when your brother works with him, he'd be willing to start taking food, because like that intimate interaction, right? Not intimate interaction with me, with brother-in-law touching, but the intimate interaction of the dog moving into the space to take the food mm-hmm. is really where some nice stuff happens. Mm-hmm. So that's what I'd suggest for you guys, and I hope that makes some sense.
Just not forcing any relationship with any man. I think, like you said at the beginning, he's a little standoffish, and we're cool with that. I love that approach. It's like, we're cool with that, with you being a little standoffish.
Play
it's
hard great. To get.
Yeah, and just respect his space, you know. But, you know, you don't want to have him running in the other room every time your brother-in-law comes over, so.
But that's the whole magic of recall, right? So all this guy Marley wanted to do every time he saw me, and same with the shepherd Shane that just went home today, let me get out of here. Yeah. Let me get out of here. Let me get out of here. The e-collar recall is like, no, come. Yeah. Be right over here. Mm-hmm. And what happens is you start to override all those habits. I'm scared. Or my habit is just I run when I'm not sure. And instead, it's like, no, come over here. And the dog's like, okay, new habit. The scary guy, I run to him. What the hell? How'd I get here? But that's how you work through it. Right. And that is the answer to that.
Thanks.
But that's why I did 9 shots.
Yeah.
Yeah!
Shots.
I want to take shots of somebody.
9.
Is shots a command?
Hi. Shots in?
Hi. It'd be great if you would just go lay down. Plots? I mean.
Okay. Question number 7 is comes from Miss Kayla.
Kayla or Kyla?
It's Kayla.
Yeah, well.
Kayla says, hi, Sean. I have a 3-year-old Kanye Corso, and she is such a great dog. I put in a lot of hard work training her, but there's one thing I can't seem to accomplish.
Yeah.
I'd gotten in a minor car accident with her in the car 9 months ago, and ever since then, she's had bad car anxiety.
Yeah.
She shakes and pants and drools. She'll lay down if I hit the smallest bump. She gets up panting and shaking.
Yeah, it's
tried
a bummer.
So much to try to fix this problem. I drive aimlessly for hours trying to wait her out. I've tried food, and she's usually food driven. I've tried getting her excited to go places she's normally excited to.
Yeah, it's a bummer, huh?
Tried to e-call her to nip the panting in the bud right as she starts, and she's slightly better, but she still continues. I bring her to work all day with me, and she's in doggy daycare for 8 hours, and still has the same anxiety driving home. You think she'd be tired? I'm at a loss. She used to love the car, and it makes me sad. She's so stressed out.
Oh, it makes us sad.
It's such a bummer.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry, Kayla.
Yeah, that is a bummer. So, Kayla, it's just a bummer because your dog's traumatized.
Yeah.
And there's no way to just remove that right now.
Anyone that says that dogs don't remember things.
Yeah, they live in the moment.
3 seconds later.
Then how come they're still so stressed out? It's just a tough one, right? So, and you've done a lot of really awesome work and really tried to find some answers. So that's fantastic, and I applaud that. You just have a super bad association going on. Your dog's just worried another big traumatic thing's going to happen. And so what I would suggest, and I know you've tried to feed her in the car before, but here's what I'd suggest, and it's a slight tweak on that, and that's she only gets fed in the car. And it's going to be hard, and it takes a bit of gumption on your part to not feel bad, not feel guilty, to say, like, wow, she hasn't eaten in 2 days. You offer her food every time in the car, right? Now, the logistics, and maybe you can help with this, the logistics, obviously you can't do it like while you're driving and like hand her the food bowl,
exactly.
At least I don't think.
Yeah.
You could do it at a stoplight, I guess. But what I want, and I want you to get this concept, is that at some point food becomes the like most important motivator that there is. But it has to. You have to generate enough hunger for that to supersede the emotional. Can you knock out Snorri Manny? To supersede the trauma association and all those memories and negative stuff that's going on. Right. So the trick is, the dog only eats in the car. I'd love for you to figure out a way, like, the dog only eats in the car. Like, I mean, I guess what you could do is you could drive, and then you could pull over, and then, you know, keep the engine running and find a safe spot and offer the dog an opportunity to eat. And I can guarantee you multiple times the dog's not going to eat. But at some point, the dog's going to get so hungry that the dog's going to go, I need to eat, right? And it could take several days, right? When we're dealing with aggression cases, we offer them food from our hands, but most of the time, they won't take it. And so it's not like we're withholding, we're offering it, but the dog's like, no, for whatever reason, I'm too anxious, I'm too stressed, I'm too pissed off, I'm too aggressive, whatever. But you always offer it, always offer it. And then there comes a point where the dog goes, yeah, okay. And then they make that move, and then you really kind of have that breakthrough. And it takes a bit, like I said, it takes some gumption and some tenacity to hold on to it and not feel guilty. Yeah. No dog's going to starve itself. Yeah. That would be my plan if I'm like, I really need to get my dog back to square one with being in the car and enjoying it. Because what will happen is eventually the association, like we pull out a dog leash, we pull out the dog food, and the dog goes, it's the same thing, except it's going to happen in the car, and the car is going to slowly start to represent that. It's tough work, but that's really the only suggestion I have for you that I know will start to turn that around for you guys.
It's going to be a process. Just think of it as a process. You know, it's that little, it's just like anything that where there's trauma, whether it's with us or any other dog or dogs or anything, it's just going to take time. So I know it sucks to think about, like, she's stressed out. Why do I have to, like, and now I'm causing more stress because she's not going to eat and, you know, that sort of thing. But the thing is, you're going to offer the food. So the food's always there. But how cool will it be if you can just picture the moment where you grab your keys to get in the car and you guys are, well, you know, long past the feeding thing in the car, but you grab your keys and she gets excited again.
She's like, dinner time.
Yeah. And the dinner time will eventually fade. You don't have to feed her in your car for life, but you can eventually fade that out. After a while, the car becomes more comfortable and becomes more safe and all this stuff. So also thinking, like, I wonder if there's a way to change it up a little bit. Like, what if you, I don't know what kind of car you have, but what if you had a crate for her in there or something, or like had a, you know, put a seat cover that's like, you know, that hammock type thing, like just something that like changes the environment a little bit and you do this. I don't know why. I was just thinking like
just
something.
Switch it up a bit.
Yeah, something that's just a little different. Like, okay, this is where we start anew. You actually get a big cushion in the back and that's where you know what I mean? Or this is like, you know, whatever, just some sort of change.
Hard to say. It's worth a shot because it's a real easy.
I mean, doing the other
in conjunction, right. Yeah. It's worth a shot because it's fairly cheap to get one of those car covers or do a crate thing. You'll have to judge and see whether the dog's more nervous being in that stuff. Yep. But I'm telling you, I learned this, you know, really clearly from a good friend trainer, Ted Epithemiaitis, that really, like, when dogs are in stressful situations, if you'll only feed them in those stressful situations and you can hold out and you can really be strong with it, you can really turn that stuff around. And I know that that's a challenging one, but it's a powerful leverage to change state of mind stuff. So shout out to Ted. And that's the way I'd go about it.
Cool.
So let us know how it works. Let us know if you make some progress. And even if what we suggest doesn't work, I think it will. But even if it doesn't, let us know what you find out or where you end up. We always like to hear back from you guys.
Yeah, cool.
Thanks
Kayla. Question number 8.
Yes.
That's from Casey. Casey
is
says...
Is it Casey Naklik?
Naklik.
Naklik. Yeah. Old friend Casey.
I think it's Naklik, but I call her Naklik.
Naklik.
Hi, Sean and Laura. I need some help with my sister-in-law's new lab. Oh, she's calling for a sister-in-law. Looks like Casey. Well, unless she's a trainer already.
I don't think she is, but I think she's stepping out.
She's got a horse in her.
I think she's stepping out and starting to do her own thing.
Love it. Casey says, he's 6 months old and I've been tasked to doing some training with him.
Uh-oh.
I put the mini educator on him and tried to find a working level. He didn't react at all until about 40. I checked the collar fit a few times for snug and high fit, and checked to make it sure it's charged, working,
yep.
all that stuff. Tried again, no reaction until 40. We're outside in grass with no real distractions. He wasn't being nutty, so I figured he's just tough. Came inside to rest a bit. I used the e-collar for a quick recall, and he yelped and lit up like he'd stood on a landmine. I did a level check, and now he's sometimes reacting to 20, but not always. Is there something wrong with my collar? I've been using it on my own dogs, but no problem.
Yeah, probably not. Okay, so I wrote up some notes for you as well, Casey, not Cleek. So it can definitely be a very different ball game inside and out, right? Almost always, even if the dog's not acting nutty, like you said, I know you're trying to read the situation, but just being outside, there's a much higher stimulation level, brain-wise. So you might find that those levels are less effective outside and then inside way too powerful. So that's something just to have on your brain. I know you're thinking about it, but I just want to reiterate. Another thing is that, and this will be, it's really like nicely showed in our e-collar DVD when it finally gets out, is that, don't laugh at that, is that we show one or two dogs that when you're finding the working level or the perception level, as we call it, you can see it. The dog doesn't give you any response. The dog doesn't look down. The dog doesn't move his head. The dog doesn't do anything, but you see every time you tap the button. Nice sound effect. And you'll see the neck move because the stimulation contracts the muscles, right? So if you're just looking at the dog's face overall or the dog's body, you might miss that. It's a subtle thing. So I always stand on the side where I can watch the e-collar receiver box, and I'm looking for any motion like that. And if I see this, any type of motion from the neck, that's where I start, right? So I'd say there's probably, I could be wrong, but I'd say there's probably a really good chance that your sister's dog was showing, if you would have been looking at that, probably you would have seen some motion at 40. That's a pretty darn high level if you've got good contact. So that's the first thing, right? So for you and anybody else watching this, a really good like hack when you're dealing with finding working levels is always watch the neck and see if you get any motion like that. And if you do, that's where I would start. So, like I said, dog was likely feeling it before 40, but here's the thing, probably didn't know what to do with it, right? So if you're rolling up the dial, check, 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 no big response, say this is even happening, but no big outward response, and you're like, dog's not feeling it. The dog doesn't know what to do. It's a novel sensation. Doesn't know what to do with this e-collar sensation. So our job is to make sure that, like, that's what I'm saying. Like, if I see this neck moving a little bit like this, I'll press, hold, and start guiding with the e-collar and start guiding with the long line or the leash to teach the dog what to do with that pressure, right? Because if you're a dog and all of a sudden you feel this like, and you don't know what the heck to do with it, it just stresses you out. But if every time you feel, and I go like this, come this way, then it starts to teach you and starts to pair with it like, oh, when I feel this, that means I should turn and come to Casey or Cassie, Casey. Where was I? So you got to make sure that, like, and I'll even do stuff like, if I'm not getting a clear response, what I'll do is, like I said, even if I don't see this, say I don't see this, I got a pretty good idea of, like, where dogs are feeling stuff. If you're above 15 on an e-collar educator mini, there's a good chance the dog's feeling it and you're too high, right? Most dogs are going to feel it between like 8 and 12. You get to 15, I'd really double check things and I'd assume the dog's feeling it. So what I'll do is, if I'm having problems and I'm getting zero response, not here, not anywhere else, then I'll let the dog get out, forge out ahead of me, press the button at a level, say like 10, excuse me, and then I'll give gentle guidance with the leash. And if I get no response from this pressure, then that means that most likely this pressure from the e-collar is not something the dog's feeling. I'll dial up a little bit, and try it again. And what I'm looking for is this clutch and gas sensation of where when I pull, I can feel the dog give to that leash pressure, but he's giving to the leash pressure because he's pairing it with the e-collar pressure. Hopefully that's not too complicated. So that's first things first. It's a hard one to explain just kind of like over the camera like this. My suspicion is dog was feeling it before 40. I would check for any kind of neck movement. I would have the line on, and if I'm not getting anything above below 15, I'd start probably at like 8 to 10 and start doing like gentle leash pulls and seeing if the dog's starting to get it. What else do I have for you? When testing, watch, yeah, I think I covered all that stuff. Feels more intense inside the house. Add leash guidance to give help. Yeah, I mean, I really covered pretty much all my bases. Yeah. Anything you think about like that?
I was just going to say the grass, you know, can seem distraction-free, but scent, sound, all that stuff, even if you have nothing around you, scent, sound, movement, air, you know, all those things, especially for a 6-month-old dog.
It's a lot.
It's a lot. So, I mean, man, just the range that the e-collar can go in for, especially dogs that have kind of like, the world is so brand new, you know. I would just remember that, you know, and maybe for this dog, when you're starting, like start everything, because after we sort this out, because you'll sort it out easy after this, then you're going to have to move to like actually proofing behaviors and doing place command and all that stuff.
Yeah.
Maybe really try it in like a garage or like a, you know, just a living room that the dog's already used to and quiet. And the dog's like, oh yeah, this is old hat. I've been here for months, you know? So that's something just to check in with it.
Yeah. So our whole new DVD is like almost entirely based around starting and getting the basic proofing stuff done inside.
Yeah.
So we have a much calmer, more relaxed, kind of stable dog to work with.
Yep.
Like you got a brand new young dog, like Laura said, out on the grass.
Yep.
It may not seem like much, but their brain's flying,
yep,
right? And so you're turning up, doesn't know what to do at that level. He's also distracted. It's just kind of a recipe for trouble.
Yeah.
I think the last thing I'm going to leave you with is just that, like, if you've got a dog on a long line and you're not sure about the response you're getting, like, apply, like, the most gentle pressure to the dog, right? Not enough to where he comes towards you, just enough to where he feels it. This is, like, maybe, like, the most insightful and magical trick that you can do as far as, like, being, like, a more sensitive and nuanced dog trainer is dogs out in front of you facing the other direction. You apply gentle pressure and hold it. And now you start to roll up a little bit on the dial. Press continuous, roll up a little bit on the dial, pull just a teeny bit more. And what you're looking for when I say clutch and gas is that moment where you feel like the dog gives. And the dog gives because the e-collar pressure just got to be enough that's significant. And the pressure pulling him back got enough to be significant to say, this is what you do with that pressure.
Mm-hmm.
I hope that makes sense. But like, that's your best problem solver. You don't even need to find a working level. Start at 2. Pressure, press the button, right? Pressure with the leash, press continuous, start rolling up, keep that pressure on, you know, with the leash, and all of a sudden you're gonna roll to a level slowly. If you get to 20, you're too high probably. Roll up, and all of a sudden you hit 12, and the dog goes, vroom, and you feel like you're not even barely pulling. That's the magic, and that's something that's really hard to teach via camera, but I'm hoping that I got it across okay.
Definitely. Cool.
Have Casey,
let us know.
Knock it out and let us know how you do, right?
Thanks.
Cool. Thanks. It's filled with vodka, by the way. It's been a long, rough week.
I know. Trust me. I know. Always
do. Want a shot?
Dang it.
Okay. Cutting back.
Okay.
Okay.
So we've got
Caddy Too Fast.
Yeah. Caddy Instagram. Too Fast from Instagram says, hey guys, 2 questions.
Yeah.
It's quick couple. One
people
is
getting greedy.
A non-negotiable. Other, I hope, makes it on the show. So let me start with the first one.
Yep, yep, yep.
What is the awesome music between questions?
What?
Can I answer that really quick?
The awesome music between questions and the intro, all the music throughout the whole show, is the music that we recorded originally for the DVD, mm-hmm. and we've hijacked it for this, but it's written by me, Dan Hasty, Tim Glum, and Jason Gutierrez. The three of us, Tim, Dan, and me, make up were the core members of a band called Orgone, who's a pretty successful band, and Orgone's still out touring, putting out records, doing all sorts of stuff. And so that's my old band, minus Sergio, who was like busy. I think he was getting married or something like that. And so Jason Gutierrez, super talented guitar player, recorded it, and we did it all at his house. So they're all personal compositions, played by yours truly on drums, and then all my good buddies. And it's pretty awesome.
Pretty cool that it's, we've used it for, we're going to use it for both DVDs.
And yeah.
It's just great to have that original stuff.
And it's got a cool vibe, too. Yeah. It's very different than anything else. So thanks for asking. Glad you dig it.
Yeah.
Appreciate it.
Okay, so the real question, got a 9-month-old pit mix on e-collar and prong with a great heel and all that jazz you preach. However, her recall is not satisfactory. When recalled,
almost disrespectful.
When recalled, she comes but takes her sweet time smelling grass along the way. No sense of urgency, so I can't really deliver a correction. Mm-hmm. But I'm not comfortable with a high or even medium distraction recall, so I haven't tried yet. Any drills for this? I'd love to get that sense of urgency from her.
Yes. This is a pretty easy one, right?
Yeah.
So if you need to, put like a 50-foot long line on just to make sure your dog doesn't run away or get into any trouble if you use some higher level corrections. But here's the deal. If your dog knows recall, start at distances that aren't crazy, that aren't wild, don't like make it a football field, and then recall, give the command, and it'll be like, it'll be like, Francis, come. And if the dog comes, great, no touch of the button, dog's moving towards you. Now, if you've got Slowpoke McGee coming, then we see this all the time. All you do is repeat the command, roll up on the dial a little bit, and simultaneously tap, right? So say your correction typically is a 20, say you're using an educator, right? And you call the dog, and you say, Francis, come, and starts moving towards you, slow poking it, then you say, come and tap the button at 20, and like a little more motion, pulls the nose out, but like not a lot of motivation. Let's go up. Now let's go to 40. Come, don't change your tone, don't get angry, don't get frustrated, right? The long line's on in case you need it, in case your dog's like, whoa, I don't know what to do with this higher pressure. And then, like I said, repeat the command, pop the button, and that higher pressure should get your dog moving. And only your dog knows what that level needs to be. So it could be 20, it could be 40, it could be 60. It really depends on like how intense your dog is distracted. But start small and then start being, start demanding accountability. We see this all the time with dogs that are slow poking around, like say even if you're like out with Hercules at the park and you're calling him and he's like, I'll be right with you, Mom.
Bang.
Right? So tell him how you do it real quick.
Yeah, so if Herc, who knows well that when I call him, he's...
That's her personal dog.
Yeah, to come running. If I, he, out in the park, probably like 15 gets him like a running. So that would be...
a running.
That would be kind of the level that I kind of hang at. And if I call him and he slow pokes and sniffs the ground, I repeat the command and I tap the button at 15. So he's like, oh, shoot. And then he comes running to me. It's like, even though he is coming my way, the command, the recall command is get your butt over here as fast as you can. Because I don't want him in the middle of the street and I call him and he sniffs and I haven't, patterned him to
get
to
your
respond
butt over
to,
here. Like,
yeah. Get that. Your butt over here.
Yeah.
If he's just walking with me and I say like, hey, buddy, get over here, or like,
yeah,
or I call
casual.
His name. Yeah, it's more casual. But if I say that actual C-O-M-E command, it's don't dilly-dally, don't sniff the ground, don't do anything, come a running.
And what happens if at 15 you tap and he like looks at you, takes a couple steps, and then goes back to sniffing?
I'm going
to
turn up and I'm going to tap again, repeat the command again. Or I may not even repeat the command. He's done that before, and I've probably not repeated the command. I've probably dialed up to 25, tap the button, and he goes, ah. Today we're at the park.
Do flames come out of his behind?
Today we're at the park. And he, because I have Kudra, I'm more focused on Kudra, so Herc's like feeling like, oh yeah, this is my park.
And you're not watching me.
Yeah, exactly. And he went running over to this dog. And I'm cool with him playing with dogs at the park because we know the dogs. Mm-hmm. But he went running over. He was off leash. Running over to this dog that was on a leash with his owner. Mm-mm. And he went just like tearing. You have no idea how sweet he is or anything. Yeah, He's terrified.
But he looks like a
pit running at your dog. Right?
His mouth is like this.
Yeah. And he's tearing towards the guy. And I said, and I was at 15, and I said, Herc, come. And I tapped the button.
At any point did you say, don't worry, he's friendly.
He's friendly.
I tapped the button. As the guy like peed his pants. Yeah.
No, I tapped the button, but he kept going towards the dog. And he kind of looked back at me like, yeah, give me 1 second. I just got this dog to see. And I didn't even look, and I dialed up. I didn't even look because I didn't want him closing the distance. Didn't even look. Just dialed up, press the button, and like he was like mid. I'm not gonna laugh at this because then I'll get in trouble. So it was not funny, but he was like mid, like jump towards the dog, like here I'm gonna make my friend on leash and possibly like hurt the dog, hurt the owner, hurt myself,
or freak anybody out.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. All of the above. Bang, and he like mid air was like bonk, and like was like just turned midway, like while he was kind of like in his leap, like turned towards me, and he came running. He was fine. He was totally fine.
Yeah,
he came running up to me and then just like walked next to me, and then we were able to like go up to the dog like in the normal way that we do things,
not the Hercules excessive way.
Exactly.
And let me just say, like, thanks for sharing that. That's awesome. Let me just say, for anybody that has a problem with what Laura just said or what I said about going higher and that you might get a vocalization, I've got, and Laura's got, zero problem with holding our dogs accountable when they've been taught fairly. It's our job. It's our responsibility to keep our dogs safe and keep everybody else safe and keep things in a good space. And the way you get that is through true accountability that's non-negotiable and not wimpy. And I don't mean that to be nasty, but I mean it's like, I called you, I've trained you fairly, these are the rules. It's like kids running out into the street. Like, you run out into the street, I'm not gonna say, little Johnny, that's dangerous. I'm probably gonna swat little Johnny's behind because I wanna create an impact psychologically that little Johnny goes, oh my God, dad's never swatted my behind before. Right. This is a really, really serious thing and I don't wanna ever do that again because it can be life and death, right? So once you've taught a dog fairly, And you're starting to implement distractions fairly, right? You don't just like go to the, after you've like got some recall trained in the house and like go to the park and like, let's see how he does. Right. Laura's done this meticulously and slowly added the stuff. But I've got no problem with a vocalization for a dog making an active choice to be disobedient when he hears a command. Sorry, buddy. Like, this is the consequence. Mm-hmm. You heard the command. You said, looked at mom. I want this, conflict of interest, consequence comes, art, dog comes running, that's it. No apologies from either of us, and that's not because we don't love, let me finish. Yeah. It's not because we don't love dogs, it's because we do love dogs. Mm-hmm. And I'm really adamant and I'm really, what's the word? Help me out.
I was jumping in, but you cut me off.
No, I just wanted to say I'm really adamant and I'm really really passionate about this, because that whole thing of like correcting dogs and doing it firmly in a vocalization is something that gets so many people unnerved, and the thing is, you love Hercules beyond belief. Mm-hmm. Your last thing you want to do is hurt him, but the most thing you want to do is have a freedom, big life, inclusion, and keep him safe.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, he totally could have been, if that dog was a big, mean, aggressive dog, he could have been attacked and killed.
Or he could have just, in an innocent fashion, freaked that dog out by just running up and bum-rushing him and make that dog aggressive or dog reactive in the future. And how fair is that to an owner? So, anyways, let's move on from that.
Cool. Thanks, Caddy Too Love.
Yeah, Caddy Too Fast.
Oh, Caddy Too Fast.
Caddy Too Love. Thanks. Glad you're digging the music, and hopefully that makes sense. Just get on the button, dial up a little bit, repeat the command, keep your voice neutral, and you should get a little more speed out of your dog.
Cool. Thanks. All right, guys.
It's like Karate Kid. I am the man who will fight for your honor. Right?
Nine.
All right. Nine to me. to both of you. I get it. That really deserved a nine.
Question number 10.
Maybe you're rating me like that was a nine on the scale of 1 to 10 of great renditions.
I saw this great thing on Instagram. It was like, on a scale from a girl who just got back from Europe for the first time to, it was like on a scale from like annoying to a girl that just got back from Europe for the first time or something, or study abroad trip.
What level are you?
But that was funny. I've definitely been that girl. I'm not dissing those girls where you come back and you're like, oh, well, in Europe.
When Spain, I really found myself, and Pablo really helped me connect to...
Pablo. He's just out there waiting for you girls. Yeah,
he's just waiting. Wow. He's waiting at the airport.
He's waiting. Okay. This is from Nellie D.
Nellie D.
Nellie D says, an odd question that I've never seen answered. Mm. I have a 5-year-old American Bulldog and an almost 2-year-old Pity. They're both awesome, but the issue comes along if I'm not present. Mm. We have chickens, and they're both totally fine with them as long as I'm there. Uh-oh. My son recently and sneakily let the Bulldog out without knowing, and he killed a chicken.
Ooh.
My question is, do I correct this low level or high? Also, I did all their training. They're awesome with me, but with the husband, they get away with nonsense, like running through thresholds, ignoring commands, stuff I never have an issue with. He honestly doesn't really care until someone comes over and points out, dang, they know who the boss is. Do I just have him start from the beginning with foundation work and run the remote myself until he catches on with the timing more? Sorry for the novel. Love you guys, and hopefully one day I can attend T3 with y'all.
Oh wow. That's awesome. Great, Nellie. What's her name? Nellie?
Nellie, yeah.
Nellie, we'd love to see you.
Yeah.
Okay, Nellie, so this sounds like a job for the one and only Hot Button Morgan.
Hot Button Morgan.
You know what that means? It's Laura's secret surprise question. I saved it to the end to kind of like throw you for a loop. I don't think we've ever done it at the end before, so.
No, because last time I don't think I got one.
Yeah.
So I was like, you guessing. I'm being thrown off.
Right.
Okay.
You might have thought it faded out.
Oh,
like I forgot about it.
Oh, yeah. Hot Button Morgan.
Yep.
Usually if you put the lovely or something like that, then I can check it out.
Yeah. I'm trying to conceal it.
I can peep it. Okay, Miss Nellie D. Basically, you are awesome, and you answered your own question in your question. You said, should I have my husband do foundation from the beginning and I run the remote, which is like, are you a trainer? That's awesome. Nine.
Give me this, I'll take care of this nine. Beast.
Okay. He's just whining. He's just him. Okay.
Nine.
Nellie, I think that's awesome. You know, you could have your husband do commands and have the dog, you know, listen, and you run the remote and do all that stuff. But the interesting part of this is that sometimes, you know, unless your husband is like, and your kids are like, oh my gosh, I get it. I'm going to keep this up after you teach me and after we do all the foundation together and all this, I'm going to keep all this up and I'm going to care about it. I think he said like he doesn't care unless someone comes and points it out, which is funny.
What a dude thing.
It's such a dude thing. But
what do you mean I'm not in control?
but yeah, so I would say that, you know, you can do all you can to try to get the dogs to respect them a little bit more. But it's kind of like, you know, the substitute teacher thing. Like, even if the teacher's in there when the sub shows up at the beginning of the class, and the teacher's like, okay, guys, we've got the sub here. I want you all to be very good for her. You know, the kids are like, uh-huh, mm-hmm. And then the teacher leaves, and the kids are like,
spitballs.
Let's get into this, yeah.
So, I mean, if he wants it.
Exactly, that's what I'm saying. If they're like, wow, we really want this, the kids and your husband are like, oh, I love this control, and I can... But if they're not, it's really kind of hard to keep that consistency. So what I would say, if they're not into it, is just you have to go a little harder when you're at home, you know, and they have to deal with the consequences of the dogs not listening to them. It's no fun, you know. Yeah. It's a lot less fun to live with dogs that aren't, you know. So if you explain to your husband, explain to your kids, look, if you guys want... you know, a dog that doesn't eat our chickens and a dog that does listen to you and doesn't like run roughshod over you, then you need to keep this stuff up.
We see this dynamic
it's
all the time.
Yeah. It's with us and owners, and it's also between two owners.
Yeah,
you know? We
just had two clients leave today, and that's their whole thing, is that the one who just left, the major issue was that mom, you know, the owner that showed up,
that's
handling everything, paying for everything, doing all the work, making the big drive, her mom, who the dog spends a lot of time with, is like, that's mean to ask more and structure and hold the dog accountable, accountable. and also the husband is not, or the fiance is not so much into it as well.
Yeah.
And so really it kind of leaves her holding the bag. And so the reality is that she's going to have to do more of the work, but the real reality is you only get what you put in.
Yeah.
So if you don't do the work with the dog's like not gonna respect them, and you're gonna be the one that's got awesome stuff that looks fantastic. So, but there's one more piece of that question before you roll, Laura Morgan.
I don't know. I was just thinking.
Yeah. And so the other piece of that question is, she wants to know how to deal with the chicken eating or chicken killing stuff, right?
Oh, that high correction.
Right, and so someone who I know, I remember with a certain polar bear and the horses and things like that.
Okay.
So maybe you could share a little bit of what you found.
That's why you said hot button, Morgan.
Yeah.
Okay. So if you want to save your chicken, if say
you
has
save your chicken,
if say husband and kids are like, that's
save
great, mom, but I'm going to let them run crazy and I'm going to let them out accidentally and whatever. I would say the best thing to do to save those chickens is there's got to be like a coop, right? We're city folk here. We don't do this, but there's a coop, right? Like where the chickens
could be,
live.
Could be.
Okay.
Or they could
like
be free range.
A fence. Oh, they're free range.
Could be.
They're
they could
organic.
Be on little leashes.
Okay. I don't know what they're on. Little prongs?
Little prongs.
If they're in a cage.
Heel.
Or
it's time to lay eggs.
In a fence yard or something like that.
There had to be some way for the dogs to get in.
Yeah. So what you want to do is create a force field. Force field around that chicken pen wherever they stay. So what you do is you set it up. You have those e-collars very high. And as soon as the dogs get close, because they probably are really interested in it, as soon as they get close to that fence or wherever that entry point or like a couple feet away.
Or just even focus.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah,
even focus.
Just like.
But what we really want to create is like those chickens are so off limits. We really want to kind of do our own invisible fence around the chickens. So Hot tamale chickens.
Yeah.
So anytime there's focus towards the chickens, it's bang at a high, high level. And I'm talking like if your dog normally corrects at like a 30, we want that to be at an 80 or even...
I'd probably go to 100.
Go to 100, yeah.
If you're dealing with like prey drive stuff like that, when you had polar bear and the horses, like give just so she gets
so
a real life
polar
example.
Polar bear was my really high drive shepherd who had crazy prey drive about the horses that he eventually went to live with. And he saw 127 on the e-collar, which is on
because he kept going after.
Yeah,
like,
I mean,
so just real quick, how was he, what was he doing with the horses?
So he would go after the horses. Like,
and
the
that
horses
looked
would
like
be, he'd tear off towards them and go to bite their ankles. So
he'd try and actually chew on them.
He'd actually try to hurt them.
Yeah.
And the problem is that he was going to get killed in an instant if that continued. Those
horses
weren't going to have that. So he... eventually had him in a down, the horse would walk slowly by, he would, as soon as he'd look at the horse, and like, I mean, I'm talking any sort of focus, he got the highest level on a collar that's bigger than yours.
1900.
Dogtra. And he really, 127, held for a little bit. And it took maybe three times for that to actually, I don't remember. It was a while ago, but
that sounds about right.
Yeah. I mean, and we're talking like a high level, but he still was like, the next time was like, I'll take it. I love those horses.
Give me those horses.
And then eventually now he at that point, he totally would avoid them and avoid the barn. We did the same sort of like e-call, like a remote, you know, e-collar, but like invisible fence around that barn.
Yeah.
So that anytime he got close to the barn, bang, even if he wasn't even like trying to go after the horses, he was like going near the barn because he could get killed. So, and with your chickens, you know, they could get, all of them could be gone.
Can I interrupt real quick? Mm-hmm. And a really curious part of this that I think goes, that dovetails nicely with what you're asking is that the woman who was working with, who Polar Bear was living with, was really smart and really good with the e-collar, but what was she trying to do to keep him away from the chickens? What kind of level? From the horses? The horse,
probably lower, right?
If I remember right, she was like 40s and 50s, and I remember you telling me she was like 40s and 50s are not going to be enough for Polar Bear, right?
That's so that, like him with a dog.
So prey drive is so intense. So I don't bring it up to like bash anybody. I bring it up to just kind of give you some context of the similarities,
and
right?
And once I told her, I was like, we need to go. She was like, oh, great. Just like, she just got it right away. She's awesome, but.
So 127 multiple times for Polar Bear for interest, focus, getting too close, anything like that, intent. Mm-hmm. 127 pressed and held, and the horses quickly became something very unsavory, or very unappetizing. And that's, if I'm not going to hijack it, but that's what you're suggesting as well for the chickens.
Yep.
I would do the same exact thing. It's basically the chickens are off limits.
Yep.
And if you do anything, like think about prey drives up here and corrections at 30, 40, 50 or down here, you're toast. Yeah. You're toast. You're never going to override this. You need to get up here and you need to get up here early in order to cap that stuff and really create a future inhibition about chickens are bad news. Don't feel bad. You're not going to hurt your dog. You're not going to cause any emotional fallout. You're not going to cause any relationship fallout. What you're going to cause is your dogs to make better choices around chickens, because if chickens are that hot, dogs don't want them. But that takes, like Laura said really well, set it up. Don't like, holy crap, they're out by the chickens. Laura went out and set up the situation to where she could be ready. Boom, bring the horses out. Polar Bear's ready. I'm ready. Bam. That's how dog trainers get through this stuff, is not by like life getting the drop on us and like, holy crap, where's the e-collar? We got to correct. It's setting up and being ready for it. Go high, get it done, and you will see big changes. You should be able to keep those dogs, no matter what, away from those chickens if you use high enough levels. And hold the, when we say hold the button, that means you're on continuous, and you hold it for a few seconds.
Cool.
What do you think?
Yeah.
Hot button Morgan. In the house. But the good news is he cohabitated with those horses and was groovy with them. So a little bit of aversive training went a long ways towards a harmonious situation. So you ready for a couple quickies?
Yeah. All right.
Quickies. These are easy.
Speed round.
So
hold on. I will ask them. Kelly, this is speed round one. You're going to have 90 seconds.
I don't need no 90 seconds.
Kelly says, while doing duration work, if they sleep through most of it, does it count? My just started working on duration with my two, and my little pit usually falls asleep within the first few minutes, and my boxer lays as though he's being tortured to death. I'm going to put in as much work into the duration as I have been on the structured walk and hope to break the reactivity foolishness, and I hope to see better results. Thanks, guys. Y'all rock.
Cool. Okay, so yeah, it's okay if your dogs fall asleep on place. It's actually good news if your pity's falling asleep on place, I think she said, or one of her, or boxer, or somebody's falling asleep on place. That's great. It just means they're relaxed and chilled out. Right. The other one needs a lot of place command because they're struggling to process and be able to just be still and just hang tough. So that's really good work. You can move the dogs around if you're getting a lot of like go to place and falling asleep with your one. You can move that one around a little bit more. The one that's struggling to just stay in one spot and like really like I'd leave them more in one, I do more stationary work and let them really process and work through that. Once again, this kind of dovetails with another question on here. You're not going to get rid of reactivity strictly by doing duration work. It can help, it definitely can help, but the real magic is going to come in how you approach that walk, e-collar, prong, early corrections, space, all the stuff we talk about. And then going out and earning it every single day and busting your butt. I know it ain't easy, but we're proud of you for keeping on trying. So that's the answer to that one.
Awesome. All right, speed round two. This is from Richard. He says, when you walk a pack of dogs, do you have a special order to place the dogs? Like, do you place the more dominant ones closer to you or maybe keep the more reactive ones in a certain spot? Thanks.
That is an interesting question because you can't see, but right there, there's a pack walk picture of me with, I don't know, like 12, 14 dogs or something. And strangely enough, who's right next to me?
Polar bear,
right? So, so Richard, my technique, we don't do a ton of pack walk stuff anymore, but we used to do a ton of it. And like, here's a great picture of like our calendar. That's
our calendar. What year is that?
2012. That's me with 12 doggies out in like Hollywood Hills. But yeah, so problem children, right next to me, right? I want to have influence. I want to be able to cause them to make better choices because they're right next to me and they know that the long arm of the law is right there. But I also want to be able to intercept and correct if I need to, specifically to those dogs. So when we do those pack walks, Polar Bear would always be the one right next to me because he was probably the most reactive dog we had. And then anybody else who would be like secondary on the list, the last thing you want is your reactive dogs far away from you where you can't really address them. Right. And then they start to stimulate the other dogs. You got to shut that down. Pack walks are great, but they can be dangerous if you can't control the energy in a large group of dogs. Yeah. So keep the nasty ones close. Be exceptionally firm with those nasty ones at the top of the walk. Set that tone. My walk, do not screw around. If you screw around, serious consequences. Let's rock. And that's how we did pack walks. And we never had pack fights or anything like that. Because that's how we kick the butt.
Okay, guys.
Cool.
That's it.
I think we're done. That was a long one, but it's kind of like our going away.
It's like our send-off one.
Aww, like semi-retirement.
So the next 6 weeks are going to be different ones. We're going to be doing some kind of specialty, different types of stuff, like maybe some split-screen webinar-style ones where we
record it. Yeah. Yep.
And
you'll be in your parka.
I'll be in my parka in Norway. And
I'll be on my bike, like filming myself while I'm riding through the French Quarter.
Awesome. We're going to figure out some stuff. So stay tuned, stick with us. We're still going to be giving the same info. It just won't be in this space.
Yeah, it'll be different, but we're trying to find a way to make it work for you guys so we can keep the nice momentum going. Once again, we always appreciate you guys. The
still
love
you.
The support.
Yeah.
Asking the questions and to be honest, like the whole concept with this is to spread the word. The more I see emails coming into us and to other trainers that are out there spreading the word and people going out and using prongs and e-collars and getting over the hump of bad behavior, boy, does that just like make me,
so
I was going to say it toots my horn, but it doesn't really toot my horn. It just makes
kind
me really excited.
Tickles
my fancy a little bit like that. That might be better. But honestly, like that's why we do this. We're so excited to be able to pass this information along. And I don't think there's a lot of places where, you know, I think you can with Jeff. I know Blake and a few other people are passing along, like, and Ted passing along really like
good info.
Yeah. The transparent information that can be scary for trainers to share. And a lot of trainers are like, I don't want to get into that.
Yeah.
But the reality is that we want you guys to know how to do better with your dogs so you guys can succeed. I mean, that's all we want. Like the last thing we want is like, hold on to all this info and you guys struggle. So that's why the DVD and the book and everything's coming out soon and you guys will be rocking and rolling even more. So anyways, I'm going to zip it up and love you guys. So appreciate it.
Thank you so much.
And keep your fingers crossed for us how the next episode goes. We'll
see
what see we
how
do.
It goes.
All right?
All right.
All right.
Oh, I'll see you next week.
Will you see me next week? No.
No. I'm so, just joking. That was the joke from the beginning of the show.
Oh,
I'm full circle.
I'm slow. Okay.
Back in the day, guys, by the way.
Oh, you want to see a quick little pack walk that I was just telling you about? Pointing out Polar Bear?
Yep.
point them out?
Oh, Poe?
Yep, there's Polar Bear.
We don't have to go through
Nope.
We'll show.
Oh, those are cute shots. Her. Anyways, all right, guys.
We love you guys.
We're out of here.
All right, see ya. See ya. We'll be right back.